Hello everyone, I'm Siddhant Sharma, a senior undergraduate in India, and today through the medium of this wonderful platform that is AppGradCon 2021, which provides an opportunity for early career researchers in astrobiology and elite fields to present their work regardless of their career stage, I'm going to be sharing you the work that we did as an all undergraduate led work that we did as a part of Blue Marble Space Institute of Science program led by our PI, our very own PI from LC, Henderson James Cleaves, along with our collaborators from Southern Denmark University, National Black Lab Florida, DLR's Aerospace Center in Germany, with some funding from LC Eon, Eon Grant, and my personal funding from a SETI Forward Award, which I'm really thankful for. So what we wanted to do is in silico modeling of reaction networks involved in prebiotic chemistry to study and understand how life originated, how simple molecules evolved to something more complex and gave way to origins of life. So we wanted to develop a computational workflow or a software where you can input a bunch of reactions, input a bunch of rules, input a bunch of molecules, and it will process them to spit out a network and then analyze those networks in a series of chained reactions to give you information about fundamental processes involved in prebiotic chemistry, such as autocatalysis, and that will help unravel the secrets that the origins of life field has been holding on. So people currently in the recent years have been doing a lot with computational modeling of these prebiotic reaction networks, and they have been doing something really good. So that's what I'm going to talk to you about in this talk. We'll go on. What we wanted to study, we studied a lot of reactions, but I'm going to be just telling you about a bunch of them due to interest of time and interest of this activity. We studied alkaline degradation of glucose and formose, which as you know, formose reaction is of significant prebiotic interest, and there are people who are studying it in experimentally, computationally using quantum chemical tools or computational chemistry approaches. And what we wanted to do in our workflow is that we took a bunch of molecules in a language, which is SMILES, and then we defined a bunch of rules. Rules are a way your transformations will occur. Rules are the way organic chemistry works, say ketoenol tautomerism or basic any chemistry basic rules, just shifts tautomerism, ketoenol tautomerism, L-dol, Michael, you get the drift. Then we define some input molecules in SMILES, and then we applied those rules using a graph grammar based package, which is MOD. MOD is developed by our collaborators in Southern Denmark University, Dr. Jacob Anderson. Then we removed, then the reaction started taking place, and through the graph theoretical approaches, you are forming a bunch of network. Then we removed the forbidden nodes or the bad structures that you don't want in our network. We then evaluated with respect to our mass spectra data that our collaborators collected or the experimental findings that people are doing with respect to these reactions. And then we used graph databases such as Neo4j to evaluate for autocatalysis. That's a basic workflow that I want to generalize, and the manuscript is coming shortly as a preprint. Now, what is graph grammars for, and how do we use graph grammars for chemical enumeration, and how does MOD work? So MOD is a software that, as I mentioned, was developed by our collaborators in Denmark, Dr. Jacob Anderson, and it's a graph theory language. It's called a GML string. So what if I want to generate a proton or generate some radicals from a species? I'll write a bunch of rules like that, and it will process your chemical transformations in a way that the computer understands. So that's how graph theory, graph grammars usually work. So you might ask me, is this a reliable technique of doing the chemical transformations? Yes, the reaction rules were very constrained. They are defined by chemical intuition and chosen manually based on what chemistries are been occurring in prebiotic atmospheres or prebiotic conditions, and all the rules are vetted. And we did some post-generation filtering of bad structures, such as no allowing of 3 or 4 members rings or 7 members ring, carbon with 2 consecutive double bonds or double bonds are very rare. And that's where our final test sets or the final data that we were getting were really vetted against all the bad substructures that we removed. Now, comparison with literatures, what we looked at a paper by Yang and Mortimer in 1996 that discussed the alkaline degradation of glucose, and same with some of the papers in Formos in recent years. We took those molecules in those papers, converted them in a form that the computer understands, and then matched what we were getting from our graph theory implementation, and then we were able to match 96% of the structures for glucose and almost 100% of the structures for formose, which is a really good thing. So our graph theory-based implementation was producing exactly the same things that we wanted to see, and the chemical diversity was really good to explore. We compared it to some high-resolution mass spectra data, which was collected by our collaborators at National Mac Lab, and then we wanted to see, based on some molecular weight cutoffs, and how sensitive your mass spectra, mass collection instrument is. So we compared our mass spectras that are developed theoretically using RDKit and Python-based implementations to the mass spectra that was coming out of the lab, and we were able to match a lot of those peaks. So here are some network statistics that I want to discuss here, and I'm going to introduce a concept which is generation. So as you know, when you apply a rule to a bunch of molecules, they undergo a reaction, but the products, once it's completed, again go back to the reactants and then start the cycle again. So that's what we call a generation. So as and when these all the rules are applied, say you are applying 40 rules to a bunch of molecules, as and when all of these apply, they will again go back and react. Again, the rules will be applied. So that's called generation by generation and generation. So as you know, as you can see on the screen, generation one took very little amount of time, produces very little amount of species, but generation five produces a lot of species and took a lot of time. And that's where we hit a bottleneck of computation. So whatever computational resources we had available as undergraduates or as a close-knit team, as opposed to high-performance computing centers or computing clusters, we were able to generate up to 5 generations for glucose and up to 6 generations for formose. And then we did some descriptive analysis for the molecules just to get some physical chemical analysis of the molecules that our graph theory based implementation was generated. Here you can see graph visualization. We then compared our molecules that were given out by generation to some biological databases such as HMDB, Human Metabolome Database, or E. coli Metabolome Database, or even KEG. So what we saw here, that very few of the matches were present. So it means that the stuff that we were generating, the molecules that we were generating, the chemical diversity we were generating was much more, unknown to what already has been present in those databases. So yes, this is the meat of the topic, autocatalytic cycles and where to find them. So we wanted to study are there any autocatalytic patterns in our reaction networks, and we used a graph based database, which is Neo4j. I personally feel this is a huge implementation of an industrial based tool that is applied in industry to solving problems in academia. We wrote some query patterns. We wrote some cycle query patterns that search for autocatalytic cycles in your reaction networks. And then what we figured out, that molecules in the, so using these graph, graph databases, we were able to write some specific queries to find these autocatalytic cycles and then get a lot of data out. As and when as we matched a lot of our outputs to the test structures using isomorphism test, we used some different algorithms to figure out how these autocatalytic patterns emerge in a set of network and what is the cycle length. And as I was mentioning, graph-based databases are very essential if you want to query a specific pattern or a specific matches, so that you can load your network and then you can query the matches. Now, what we wanted to introduce some thermodynamics so as to vet our autocatalytic cycles based on thermodynamical feasibility, that whatever cycles we are getting are perfectly spontaneous, are spontaneous. And what we did was we used semi-empirical methods such as equilibrator. And here's a simple example of an autocatalytic motif or loop where pyruvic acid acts as a catalytic molecule and it's fed by a lot of different prebiotically relevant molecules. Now, before you do a thermodynamic wetting, you can see a cycle length increasing, but these all are non-spontaneous as given by the delta G values. When you wet these on spontaneity, you can get these cycle length values, and that's what we wanted to do. We wanted to find out appearances of certain lengths based on the spontaneity, and we found a lot many autocatalytic cycles. Doing this through quantum chemical methods or more computationally expensive methods would be a waste of computational resources, and we didn't have that. So we settled for a nice semi-empirical methods that is equilibrator, which is being currently applied to study a lot of biochemical cycles and biochemical pathways using group contribution methods. Now, what are the future questions that we would like to answer based on the conclusion of our talk? So how do different reaction networks converge? For example, if there are two or three different reaction networks occurring simultaneously, how do they converge and how do they interact together in an environment? How about including prebiotic temperatures and pH? Since we never included any prebiotic pHs or prebiotic temperatures, which is a thing for which you need more computing or more compute clusters. And solving the stereochemical black box, we never looked at stereochemistry at a more defined angle, and it's really hard to figure out stereochemistry in a graph theoretical setting, and making this workflow more modifiable so that other people can include, say they want to use a different tool as opposed to Neo4j, they can easily integrate that tool. Calculating the kinetics of the reactions participating in the reaction networks is one more thing. We looked at thermodynamics, but we wanted to look at kinetics too. So there's one more paper that's in prep, which deals with how some news and progress about automated processes to explore chemical reaction networks. Last, I just wanted to acknowledge, and coming on to my, I just wanted to acknowledge all the wonderful people that I have worked as an undergraduate in the past one and a half years, and all the funding, all the support I have received from all these wonderful people that have shared my interest in prebiotic chemistry and origins of life and made me an interdisciplinary person. So thank you all the people, thank you Dr. Jim, and thanks to my wonderful team through which this work has been made possible. Thank you.